In 1976, I presented a children's magazine programme from this very studio. It had phone-ins, cartoons, competitions, guests. It was just a little thing to replace Flash Gordon and Champion the Wonder Horse. Well, 20 years later, they're still at it. The children who used to watch me on the multicoloured swap shop have now got children of their own who watch this programme. And really, not a lot's changed. The set's a bit different, the fashions have altered. But basically, we've all been watching the same show for the last 20 years. So how have the BBC got away with it? Well, I think it's time to explain. Z Shed was my first introduction to presenting live children's TV with a phone-in, and it gave us some very interesting ideas for the new show. But how were we going to fill an entire Saturday morning with next to no money? Rosemary Gill had an idea.
I remembered that swapping had always been a great thing. I think for every child likes to swap. And you could use that word not just for swapping goods, but for swapping ideas and swapping clothes and swapping stories and swapping jokes, and there was no end to it, really.
Can we do a swap? You always seem yeah. to bring along.
I've got three, actually. Things. Are they all going to be swapped together?
Well, please, yes, if you don't mind putting it to a...
Anybody that saw the Shadows and I reunion concert would have seen that show. I wore it on stage then. It's really nice.
Yeah.
And I thought, if a girl won it, it's a great disco outfit, and if a boy wins it, you better get into a band.
Now, what are you offering?
A colour TV game.
A colour TV game?
Ooh. Optional gun and the adapter.
Optional gun? I don't know why that should sound funny, it just does. And adapter. And what would you hope to get?
29 function digital watch.
29 function?
Digital watch.
And for someone like Noel, it was tremendous. It just gave him things to bounce off. Which was one of the great bases of the programme.
How do you get up to 29?
Don't know.
You've obviously seen one advertised somewhere.
On Swap Shop.
Oh. Oh, fair dues, Daniel. I obviously don't concentrate on what's going on here.
Hello again.
I'd worked on John Creator's newsroom with John, and I wanted to put, I say, a bit of grit into the programme. And we brought John in to do that, not realising that, in fact, he was going to put a great deal of comedy into the programme.
Where do fishes keep their money?
I don't know. Where do fishes keep their money?
In the riverbank.
In a current account.
You've always got to do one better, haven't you?
Don't get annoyed.
And then I just had a letter out of the blue from a fresh-faced young man from Liverpool called Keith Chegwin, just at the time that Rosemary was looking for someone to do the OB.
We're actually being overlooked by the Blackpool Tower there, and it really is an eyeful.
Basically, I lied my way onto the show. I was an out-of-work actor, and I had nothing to do whatsoever. And I was watching TV one night, and I saw Valerie Singleton. I thought, I'd like to be a TV presenter. So I wrote this ridiculous letter to the BBC suggesting a children's programme, you know. And on the other page, I thought, I'll write a load of lies, like I've been a presenter for 14 years and done this and that.
And at the end it said, P.S. I am 19. I thought, well, we must meet this chap. And he was lovely. Mm-hmm.
We got street racers, any offers?
Oh, perfect. Let's have a look. Right, got street racing, any offers at all?
The whole point of this show was it was going to be a programme for children to phone in. And we went on air, and I remember the phones didn't ring. There were people sitting behind us, ready to man the phones, and nothing was happening. And in fact, the first slot that was allocated for you to talk to the children, we had to abandon it. And we thought, this is going to be a disaster. And then the phones did start ringing, and they never stopped.
Where would you most like to be a fly on the wall? I've got you there, haven't I?
No, you haven't, no. I'm just thinking about it. Where would I most like to be a fly on the wall? It'd have to be upstairs here, actually. It would definitely have to be upstairs.
That's boring.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Simon Meadows, for the first time we actually meet 15 years on. Millions of children, of course, wanted to get through to Swap Shop. You were one of the lucky ones. What was it like?
It was incredible. It was like winning the national lottery. Here I've been trying for years, every Saturday morning, running up my dad's phone bill, trying to get through. And finally I was on there, and I think I really went for it.
Now, come on, where would you like to be, clever Dick?
Well, the royal family's going to hate me now, aren't they? I'd like to be on fly on the wall when Charles takes Diana out to dinner.
This is not Nigel Dempster, is it? Who have we got?
I really sounded horrendous. I was a brat. I'm sorry.
15 years on, apology accepted. What do you do these days?
Well, ironically enough, I now work in television. I work as a journalist, and I'm still phoning people. I'm still hassling them on the phone. So now I do it professionally, and not a lot's changed.
Nothing changes.
Maxwell Smith, who's seven, has written from Rotherham in Yorkshire. He says, will you please help me to find my teddy bear? I left him in a little chef cafe at Bodle Widden on the A55 on our way home from North Wales. And he's done a drawing of little Ted for us there. Can you see little Ted? And he's 10 inches high, and he's not got much fur, and he's a dirty gold colour. And yes.
Well, I think they developed a real sort of family relationship. They were all totally different, and they all enjoyed each other's company. And of course, as Maggie was the only girl, she's the one that used to get teased. But she dealt with this with no trouble at all. Great aplomb.
They haven't put their address on or anything.
Oh, well, pick one that does. It's nice of Andy Pandy to let you out today, by the way.
I'm sorry, I couldn't resist it.
There's no address on that one either.
Oh, get in the bin and find one, for goodness sake.
Go on, you can do it.
Go on, there must be one in there.
Got one. It goes to Christopher.
She looks like Andy Pandy now.
It might seem that Swap Shop, live and unrehearsed, was an unusually dangerous programme for the BBC to be broadcasting in the 70s. However, ITV already had a Saturday morning children's show without any of the virtues of swapping. It had custard pies, a compost corner, and a large chap in a black hat and cape who would throw flans at unsuspecting children and presenters. The BBC's task was therefore simple: to rescue the viewer from a breakdown in society, otherwise known as Tiswas.
The whole rule was nothing must last more than 3 minutes. You know, and after 3 minutes, a zap on to the next thing, because people's boredom level, obviously Chris used to think that the boredom level of everyone was ran out after 3 minutes. There was one particular week when Chris was in a particularly ghastly mood, and he said to me, I don't think you get enough custard pies. I think we really ought to give you a lot of custard pies 1 week. So he said, I'm going to run through the mail and see if I can find people requesting you getting gunge. And I think he made all of the letters up.
Last week, Chris had a lot of spaghetti poured over him. I love things like that. But it would please me much more if Sally J. Well, I think we can arrange that. That shouldn't be any problem.
And I think it was the worst combination that anyone on Tiswas ever received.
Nigel Baverstock of Liverpool says, I'd like to see Sally with a whole bucket of something thrown at her from close range. Well, I think we can manage that without any problem at all. Great.
It was much more anarchic, and they had people being bombarded by gunge and all that. They were the first people to do that, which we were a bit snooty about in a way. We thought that we were doing our thing, they were doing theirs, and I think they had their own, we all had our own following.
I mean, I think we were fun, and Swap Shop was a little bit educational. It was very tame by comparison.
You are our collectors of this week. And what a marvellous collection. Who's going to tell me about it first? How did it come about?
Well,
I do remember receiving a lot of unusual gifts. Mm. Were you ever sent anything unusual?
Well, no, but I was normally the butt of many of your jokes and gifts. Just I was.
No.
You'd try things out on me live on TV.
Now, the idea is you get a good load in your mouth, on your tongue, and then let us have a
listen. Am I insured for this?
And then let us have a listen. Because we ought to be able to hear something, right? Up there. Don't actually do anything with it, you just let us have a listen. Open your mouth. It does look good.
Thank you.
We tried it on a pigeon and it died, but...
do you not remember the constant dialogue about your hair? I'd like to see your face as you read it.
All right. Could you please tell me if it's true that John Craven wears a hairpiece, as I've heard... as I've heard many rumours about it.
Yes, yes, and the fact that I look like Mr. Spock.
Yes.
Ah, Mr. Speck, what kept you?
What seems to be the problem, Captain? Why this display of emotion?
The problem is...
We are heading out of control towards a previously unknown planet, and unless checked, the total destruction of our team is inevitable, and Grandstam will just have to start earlier.
And having established the fact that you were hired entirely for your gravitas and your broadcasting strengths, how come you ended up with your arm up this thing?
Yes? Can we... Oh, excuse me. It's for you. Hello?
I think it was a videotape. It wasn't ready and couldn't be shown. And so there was a... Yeah, there was a slight pause, or rather a long pause. So Lamb was scattered along on the table along with the other soft toys. And I just sort of grabbed him and disappeared under the table and brought him up.
We unfortunately don't have any mint sauce... But I shall be meeting the I shall be meeting the group a little bit later. A chance now for you to see brown sauce.
I just wanna be a winner. Just a little Oscar, please. I just wanna be a winner.
The group Brown Sauce came about because they were about to do a program called the Swap Shop Awards. And I think one of the people producers on the programme had tried to book various bands and couldn't. And Noel came up with this idea. Well, look, if we can't get a band, why don't we do it ourselves? Anyway, it got to number 15.
And it was only meant for a joke. It was quite a surprise.
But all those marvellous things like Eric.
Yeah.
I mean, that just happened, didn't it?
Yeah.
He just did it. Because they had this thing that came down with the results to the one of the competitions. And he just suddenly looked up and said,
Eric, good morning. Can we please have the top 10 swaps?
This then became a complete... character, and,
well, so much,
yeah. And it was he had his own fan club, didn't he, Eric?
Yes, he did.
Didn't exist.
He also got some very complicated memos from sort of administrative people because they thought he was real, and they were not entitled to another charge hand in the roof. They said, "Of course, there's nobody there."
Don't do that, Eric, please. Right, it's all right. We'll put him out on the OB again as soon as possible.
I love the outside broadcast on Swap Shop. And even Superstore. I don't know that... I always found the studio environment very restrictive, and it was so nice to sort of, like, meet the people, the general public.
How many swaps have we got left to do? Can you hold up the swaps that we've still got left? We haven't got many, have we? We'd be running out soon.
And Noel would just take it upon himself at sort of, like, I don't know, 9:32 to say, let's have a look and see, where are you, Keith? And I'd be there having a cup of coffee, doing up my shoelaces, you know.
Keith, where are you?
I think we've caught him out, whatever he's doing.
Love it, love it, love it.
You knew you were on a winner from the first one. You get a feeling about something that's really good.
And then in the end, it ran for 6 years instead of 6 weeks. It just went on.
Maggie, John and I have nicked something off the set, and it's yours.
Splendid. A big, big thank you to all of you who've been watching us for the last 6 years. Thank you very much indeed. A personal thank you from me to all the names you're about to see. From the Swap Shop team, goodbye.
Hello, I'm Mike Reed. It's 9:30 on Saturday morning and time for me to open the Saturday Superstore.
Saturday morning, get down to the Superstore.
So, after 6 years, the Swap Shop was demolished and the Saturday Superstore was built in its place. There was one last swap, however. It was me. I was swapped for Radio 1 DJ Mike Reed. So it was all change. Or was it?
Well, it wasn't all that different, to be honest.
Wasn't it?
No, not really. Oh. I mean, same sort of format, really.
The murky mornings are here again. It's Superstore time, isn't it?
I'm so used to getting up at 5:30, you know, for the radio show. This morning the alarm went at 7. I thought, I'm late! I thought, oh, it's Saturday.
You're awake now.
I'm awake now, yeah. Golly.
The first programme, I think, was probably, I don't know, the most nerve-wracking, because you're probably numb, because it's so new. You think, what's going on? And on the first programme, as well, we had a phone call out of the blue from America, from Elton John.
Hello!
How are you?
I'm fine. Where are you calling from?
It's so early in the morning, I don't know where I am.
What? The programme had such a nice status about it. I'm talking about the Saturday morning slot in general, from Swap Shop onwards, that people would do that.
Morning! This is the delivery van. Yes, we're going to be delivering goods to you all over the country. Rain, hail, snow, a storm. Yes, you guessed it, we're going to be here. And it is a bit wet this morning, but who cares? Because just have a look at this delivery van. It really is superb.
It was nice on the delivery van because, like, it gave us the opportunity, a total contrast to Swap Shop, where we just did swaps and had the odd interviewee. It gave us the chance to sort of like have live bands and music on the road. And I always remember sitting in the office deciding, you know, between two bands who to have on the show. And I turned around and said, oh, that band sounds pretty good. And they were good. It was wet, wet, wet. And we gave them their first ever TV appearance. But what a team. It just seemed to gel and everything seemed to work.
I think presenters find the programme and the programme finds presenters. It's a very special form of programming and it requires very special kinds of presenters. And fortunately, there's always been someone around at the right time.
But where do I fit into all of this?
Chris Bellinger had done 1 year of Saturday Superstore and they were happy with the way it was going, but they wanted to add another element. They wanted to bring a female in to work off Mike Reed and Keith Chegwin.
They're clip-ons, so they won't Ow. Hurt you too much.
Actually, don't they hurt your ears, the girl?
No, look, they are. How's that, hey? What do you think of those?
Yeah, there was a balance, really, between my stupidity, Sarah's sophistication, and Keith's buoyancy and John Craven's solidarity.
Yeah. Superstore continued the Swap Shop tradition by having an amazing guest list, but on one occasion you did pull off a political coup.
Yes, when we had all three political leaders in one after the other. We had David Steele and Neil Kinnock and then Margaret Thatcher when she was Prime Minister.
And there's a second prize,
yeah.
Which is this little alliance bear.
Mm-hmm.
He's called Gladstone.
Gladstone.
And he's got his own tin of House of Commons fruit drops.
Right. And this is a teddy bear that appears with a vest. Join the cuddly left.
And we'll show you round number 10 and we'll give you tea at number 10 and I'm sure you'll love it.
They're not going to be given an easy time, but they will feel very relaxed because they'll be walking into a bright, colourful atmosphere, noisy atmosphere, and then be asked very straight questions.
Hello, Alison.
Hello. In the event of a nuclear war, where will you be?
Oh, my goodness me.
I'll be in London, dear. Where?
I should be in London.
Oh, don't you have your own bunker or something?
Look, dear, let me again point out.
But the one thing I did notice, and you might just sort of like glimpse me looking down at her legs, the one thing I did notice is that she had very hairy legs. And I was sat there during the interview thinking to myself, I wonder if she shaves them when she goes to sort of like, you know, some big sort of like important do.
I mean, Keith was always so up. He was charged. I mean, I think he was probably zonked by Saturday afternoon, but, you know, if Sarah and myself came in a bit, you know, been a late night the night before, Keith was always, hey, come on, hey, how are you going? You said you couldn't fail to be carried along by him.
He's got to let beat, his mind's making promises his body can't keep. Who is making promises they lose to sleep?
I'm going to say, I think the worst record ever made is a record called Two Left Feet with Mike Reed and Sarah Green. I mean, oh, jeez. I think I'll get the singing career in this.
Contrary to popular opinion, I didn't like the singing.
Which is a bit surprising, really, bearing in mind how good she was at it.
Let's get on with it now, will you?
And, of course, despite the singing, every Saturday morning, millions of growing boys would tune in to admire Sarah's presentational skills.
And the grown-up boys.
First thing we're going to do is start walking forward on your bum, OK? Move forward. Three.
The Green Goddess was the big thing in those days, Diana Moran doing her fitness classes in the morning. So I thought I'd do an anti-fitness class and we'd learn how to do things that would expend as little energy as possible, like how to put your jeans on without getting out of bed in the morning.
Really squeeze the cheeks in, you know, like you're trying to put a 50-pound note there.
One good thing about Superstore was having the talent competition every series, wasn't it? Because we had some really good talent.
Really good.
If I make it to the top, I don't want to be there on my own.
Unfortunately, some of those people went on to do it professionally, which is fantastic.
Every day I hope I won't be late, 'cause every day is waiting by the school gate. And the biggest of all my dreams is up to your extremities, 'cause it's horrible being a little bit more than eight.
The Saturday Superstore Superstar.
You did it.
Of 1987. And here is a clue. It's the plural. They're called the Juvenile Jazz from Liverpool.
It was quite unique because he came on to present a prize.
Yep.
And I said, why don't you stay and sort of, you know, co-host the programme? And he said, well, yeah, OK, not doing anything else. And we ended up doing a live phone-in.
Good morning.
How do you feel about your brothers and sisters being married?
Well, why are your brothers and sisters married?
No.
Oh, I see. Well, I mean, it's terrific. Why? Do you think... Why? Because I'm the only one left, you mean?
Yes.
There is no other slot on television like it, because there is a sort of naughtiness, a mischievousness attached to it, if you like, that you can get away with.
Now, you've come as the fairy.
I have indeed, yes.
So are you going to sit on our Christmas tree?
I'm not going to get those pines up my... What? Get a what? Broom
well, there. We'd make a nice...
Have you ever had pine needles up your brush?
Oh, no.
Can you whisper to me? I'll sort it out for you. Do you? Someone will tell you where it is. George can't take you because he's...
Leave it out. It's annoying.
Hello?
I just one thing to say. Happy Easter. And that's my cream egg trick. Bye-bye.
Oh, no.
The first one is the new single from King. This is called Torture. And after we've seen the video, we'll have the vote from the panel. At least that's what they said to me. We do have it, do we?
Might not.
Oh, sorry, keep going. Right, keep going. Well, I didn't like wearing an earpiece. I think that was the only bone of contention we had, really. And Chris Bellinger,
he used to give me grief.
Oh, he did. But he couldn't give me that much grief because I hadn't got an earpiece
in,
so I couldn't hear him. Well, King is coming up in a moment, then after, and I won't tell you what we've got next because it'll spoil the surprise for you. But we are going to be voting for the very first time. I am. So sometimes they couldn't get to me to say, what are you doing? We are going to be voting for the very first time, so you can score 5 points each.
You just said that.
But it's not... But it's not... It's just so you get it.
When it actually worked, the pop panel was an opportunity for the week's guests to air their expert opinion about the new releases. And it really helped if they knew something about pop music.
For me, it was a bit noisy, and I'm more interested in the words.
Come on then, Delia, what were the words?
Hey, diddle, dum, diddle. Otherwise, it was thump, thump, thump. I accept very professional, but nothing like heartache.
And I like the colour effects, rather like the Financial Times, isn't it?
Well, I actually think there should be a law against things like that. I think it's absolutely horrible.
I loved it. I absolutely loved it, and it was continuing to evolve.
There is a lifespan to a programme. I mean, it may be that the presenters are moving on to something else. It may be that that the format needs a little bit of a shake-up. But it sort of becomes clear to everyone, the audience included, that a programme has run its course.
I'd like to say thank you to everybody who's written in to Superstore, everybody who's phoned the programme, because you really kept it going over the last 5 years. And I'm going to stop saying thank you now, so I'm going to burst into tears.
For the third incarnation of the show, it must have been tempting to stick with the swapping, selling theme of the first two. Saturday Stock Exchange, maybe? But no. The swaps and the shops were abandoned forever. It was time to get on with the show. Sarah Green was already on board, and plucked from Children's BBC's prestigious broom cupboard was Philip Schofield.
Well, this is still wet.
Oh, they said they were going to get it all finished. I hope the rest of it's finished.
Look,
let's have a look.
Oh, it's dark.
Studio 7, Television Centre.
Hi.
Here we are, going live.
It worried me a great deal, having to go from one thing to another, and it being clear enough in people's minds that we were starting off something new, but that there was enough familiarity to bring people along with us. And I think the thing that helped me turn the corner was my relationship with Phil. It was just an instant chemistry.
And one of these days, these boots are gonna walk all over you.
Are you laughing?
I wanted to present Saturday morning television right from the very first ever day Swap Shop came on the air. And I remember thinking, this is all I want to do. This is the only thing I want to do. And it was extraordinary to end up doing it. I don't think I ever lost the feeling of I can't quite believe I'm doing this.
Hello to Alan Davidson, our friend, who just got out of jail today for some terrible crimes.
Crimes involving penguins.
You don't want to know about them.
There have been people over the years who walked into the studio, could see what it was that we were doing and thought, right, I'm definitely in on this.
Trev, this is Trev.
Oh, I am so pleased to meet you.
Oh, yes, I'm sure you are.
I'm a huge fan of yours.
Really?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I don't listen to pop music. Who is she?
Now, for the first time, professional comedians were added to the show. Auditions were held, and Trev Neal and Simon Hickson, two regulars on the London comedy circuit, plucked up their courage and showed a tape of their act to the programme's editor.
Chris, he didn't really laugh, and he just said, well, there's about one joke that's suitable there for our audience. And that was a joke we did called the Egg and Spoon Race. And we'd hold up a spoon, we'd hold up an egg, and we'd put it on the ground, and we'd go, come on!
Trevor and Simon had that remarkable ability to wipe me out every single time. I think they are amongst the finest there. And when they are on top form, they are just flying.
You start off and we'll join in.
Are you still into pants?
Oh, yes, oh, we want to swing them like a hat.
Frog when a-courting, he did ride a-hum, a-hum. Frog when a-courting, he did ride a-hum, a-hum.
You are on one side.
I am on the other.
Are we divided?
Oh, yes, I think we are divided. We better swap places.
Okay, then.
Here we go, then.
Philip and Sarah were, as far as we were concerned, established BBC presenters.
They were like our mums and dads.
They're sick. They really are sick.
And that was the kind of relationship we set up, really. We were the kind of naughty boys.
Cheer us all up, please. Do your business on the piano.
Oh, no, I won't, but I'll play a tune if you like. Oh.
Goodbye, everybody.
You can put an awful lot of attention into these programmes. You can worry about the style and the content of the features, the running order, those very expensive opening titles, the look of the set, the music, the star guests. And whatever you do, you can be absolutely certain that despite your very best efforts, you will always be upstaged by a squeaky sock in a leather jacket.
Which was basically, that's it in a nutshell. I mean, that's how it worked. I think that's certainly how it worked.
People used to actually address Gordon as much as they'd address us because of the strength of the character.
Gordon the gopher, I'm yearning to smooch you. Gordon the gopher, can I have a small hand in your future? Gordon the gopher.
Get off me! He's got my finger! Let go, Gordon!
Yeah, all right, Gordon!
I love your beetle disguise. I love the beard. I wouldn't have recognised you.
Go! Ooh!
Oh!
Yes, all right, Gordon!
I hope you can get it on.
We will, don't worry. We'll work very hard on that.
Yeah. Sexy.
That I go first.
When you're going to have a poignant moment, it's going to have all the more weight attached to it because it comes within all that laughter.
Open up your mind, let your fantasies unwind in this darkness which you know you cannot find. The darkness of the music of.
I think there's been too many favourite moments to tell you about now, but I suppose the Helen and Damien, the Down syndrome dancers who came out of the talent competition that we held, to see them performing in the studio was so gratifying and so wonderful.
You can't follow that, you can't say anything. I mean, it was worth every mile of the way to come to see that again.
You will see people doing stuff they would not do elsewhere, and you will also get guests coming on because they trust the programme because they've had a good time before or because it's the right forum for what they want to get across. And there I'm thinking about Terry Waite.
I don't think that I hated them. And it seems to me the difference between anger and hate. Anger, we all get angry. But to hate people seems to me to be as though you want them to be destroyed in some way.
And he was very much still recovering. You can see that in his manner, in his bearing. But he felt comfortable enough to come and talk about his experiences.
I can understand why they did what they did, although I don't agree with it, because hostage-taking and terrorism often arises, comes in situations where people are very frustrated, fed up.
The audience's involvement in the programme is crucial. Without them, there is no programme. They contribute in so many ways.
Who's on five?
Liveline was great. Liveline was fun. To be able to call out to your audiences was stunning, although, you know, it so often didn't work.
Hold on a second. You can only fill for so long, can't you, really?
Did I get a dialing tone?
Things always seem torturously long when you're waiting, don't they?
British Telecom are looking into it for us. Surely not. Surely we're not that important. Surely we don't have people rushing around in vans and things.
We'd worked for ages in trying to get someone into someone's house as a surprise. And the pop stars always were, of the day, were of course, guaranteed to get the best reaction.
Who's your favourite pop group?
Take That.
Who?
Take That.
Who are they?
Pop group.
Are they? Are they any good?
Brilliant.
Are they?
Yeah.
All right. Right, get your muscles flexed. Here we go. Do you want to open that door for me? Right, do you want to go some breakfast?
We've got some buns.
Breakfast time.
Right. Cornflakes and that. All right.
Look at this.
Hello.
Oh, she's crying.
I mean, I say best reactions. Great, great faces, very few words.
Don't cry. Oh, that's going to be all right. Yeah, I get some tissue.
We've got nice eggs in there. We've got the best ones.
Obviously, be on the price.
I hope that we do provide a balance within the programme so that you can hook those viewers who may not necessarily want to see, an item about anorexia, but who will be encouraged to see it because they've been captivated by the lighter, less demanding material.
I don't want to tell my mum how I feel, and my dad isn't really that close. I'm scared in case my friends find out. Please help.
OK, well...
Our agony uncle that we had, Philip Hodson, had to address some very tricky problems. Some came in on the phone, but mostly by letter.
Your stepdad is lying to you for two reasons. First reason is, if you tell, he might be stopped. The second reason is, if you tell, he might go to prison. Those are the real reasons why he's telling you not to say anything to anyone.
We were at a friend's house having tea, and they came in with guns, and they took the men away and said that they would be back in the morning. But they went back in the morning, and we heard that they'd been taken to Baghdad. They took my dad away.
When he was just 12, Sir Hugh Casson, no less, proclaimed Stephen a genius, saying that he was the greatest child artist in Britain that he'd ever seen. What makes this even more incredible is that Stephen is autistic.
Am I allowed to look now?
Yes.
Because I've kept away whilst you've been doing this so that... That is quite staggering. I think it's absolutely brilliant.
Just don't let your disability get you down, because there's a lot of things that disabled people can do now. And I live a busy, happy, full life.
So while the viewers took care of the hard, factual aspects of going live, Philip Schofield was left to indulge his ridiculous James Bond fantasies. You all right down there, Phil?
Shouldn't I have gloves on? I'm sure I should.
It's not very dignified, Vince, is it?
I'll show you one
hole,
just
that one. That's fast.
There's a big wake here. There's the first marker.
I broke two powerboat records. I have the certificates I've got at home now in my little cabinet, signed by Princess Anne, sitting on a...
The results for Philip Schofield, average 42.98. A new world and national record.
Oh, he's a clever boy.
I think we've always been very lucky on a Saturday morning with our presenting team from Swap Shop with Noel and Keith and John. and all the way through to last series of Live and Kicking with Andy and Emma. And it's, I think that's been a strength of the programme. But there have also been some combinations that haven't been so apparent, that so obvious, that I've enjoyed. For example, Philip and Emma's cooking.
I sort of targeted Going Live as my dream show I would like to get on, and I basically plagued the editor, Chris Bellinger, with a lot of letters and showreels and 52 ideas that I would bike round to him at the drop of a hat. And he very kindly one day just saw me out of the blue and said, I have two presenters, what could you do on my show? And off the top of my head, I kind of went, cookery? And he said, 6 minutes next Saturday and we'll see if it works.
Thank you, I have driven a train.
Sorry.
I do know how to work a whisk.
Sorry. Forgot how busy you are. That's a little bit slower, Philip.
Okay. No, it's out of control! How much longer is there? Haven't we got a lot more to do?
Yeah.
Have we?
Okay. We're nowhere near the end yet.
Are we?
No.
We've got 30 seconds left.
30 seconds?
Forget it. Sorry, it's okay.
Then I need some of this. What's happening?
My ring's come off.
No. Leave that there. Put that on that.
Right.
Okay? And mould it into the shape of a ball.
It got to the stage where Emma was asking me to do the impossible because she knew that it would fall apart. She knew that I couldn't accomplish the feat that I'd been asked to accomplish.
Philip, this is...
No, I will not give up! Get
Sorry
up,
about
get
that.
Up, get out of it, get out of it! It's supposed to go... Well, no, you didn't tip it quite, over like that, no?
It's quite hot as well.
Oh, it's just come out of the oven! Next week... We're going to show you how to get the tin foil out.
Did you cook these, Emma?
I did, actually. Yes.
Oh, she likes an idea. There were times when guests would be suggested and we would all feel, oh, would they be right? Yeah, maybe, let's go with it. But I remember one time it was suggested that Barry Manilow come on the show. And I just thought, I can't see it. And this is a cool show.
Her name was
Gordon the Gopher.
What are you saying?
But no, I was convinced by people in the office, by producers, that he was the guest of the moment. We must have him. And of course, they were so right. He turned out to be just the funniest guest, and he wasn't a bit uptight. I've been led to believe that he could be a bit uptight about the size of his nose.
Do you notice a similarity here? You know, what do you think, Chris? Profiles, right?
Barry, I never said a word.
Yeah, but I could see you thinking it. I saw it in your eyes.
Both Sarah and I agreed that that it would be right to finish when people said, I can't believe that it's coming to an end. I can't believe you've both decided that you want to pack it in. There's so much more to do. And that's when we decided, three of us, Gordon involved, of course, that we would call it a day when everybody still wanted more.
And it felt very natural doing it that way.
This is the moment we've been dreading, when we actually go...
We go like this and say, thank you very much for your letters, your phone calls, your all about me's, your ideas. Thank you very much.
Thanks to all our guests over the years, and thanks to all our crews over the years, and thanks to Sarah.
And to Bill. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you soon.
Hello, it's 9 o'clock and you're watching BBC One for the very first edition of Live and Kicking! Woo!
It was very different being a main presenter on it because obviously I'd always avidly watched it and that was what I was aspiring to do. So it was a really huge change for me, but it was everything and more that I thought it was going to be.
1993 saw an almost new name and an almost new lineup. Emma Forbes was promoted from the kitchen, John Barrowman sidestepped from the stage to the screen, and Andy Peters was another graduate from the mighty broom cupboard. Chuck in Trevor Simon, you've got an awful lot to pack into 3 hours and a bit.
Every week we will be here at this time for the next 7 months.
Seven months?
Yeah, 7 months.
I thought it was 7 minutes.
I thought it was the 7 seas of Ryebike Week.
When you look back at programmes such as Swap Shop, Superstore and Going Live and compare them to Live and Kicking, if you watch a tape of it, the first thing you'll notice is the speed at which Live and Kicking moves.
You are supreme! Oh, blimey! The beast lightning!
I too am a very frustrated singer. It must be something about being on Saturday mornings and being close to all those bands and everything.
Cause I need a man. My heart is set on you.
We had this little mini and, oh well, we'd put guests in there and we'd do this fake driving test.
Oh, well, hang on a minute. If you're Jason Orange, then, are you Howard Grape and Mark Apple?
Yeah.
You are sponsor, Mr. Ribbon.
Have you ever stroked a weasel? Have you ever stroked a weasel?
Hey, look, here's one.
Oh, hello.
Famous for 5 minutes for me was one of the best parts of the show because it's a real opportunity to find out what is going to happen, where you sit at the edge of your seat and think, this could all go terribly, terribly wrong.
Is this your house? Is this you? Hello there.
Oh, my God.
Vicky, why bother to send you to the polls winners party when we've got E17 in your house right now? If I go in the room, you'll see who we are making famous for 5 minutes.
I remember the camera went and we burst into their living room and the two of them were sitting there in their pyjamas. This isn't cool. And they were quite sort of offish with me.
Daryl and Sam, good morning. Daryl and Sam.
There are actually a production team down there, and they actually said, look, come on, guys, we know you can do Smashy and Nicey, and we know you do it very well. And actually, 2 hours later, they came back on and were fantastic.
Great, Red, and I'd love to stay and chat all day, but I've got to make a move. This is my Smash A, ba 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 day day ba 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 diggy diggy day day bye bye.
Yes!
And even, you know, 2 years later, Daryl came back again and happened to actually be a finalist in one of our competitions.
Hey, monkey boy, you think you can scare Emma and get away with it? No chance, puppy pants. Get out of here. Oh, Ace!
And what about those two comic geniuses, Trev and Simon, or as they become known in the footer, who?
The characters, people, a lot of people say, you know, where do the characters come from? And what happens is we pick them up at the bus stop, kind of down at Shepherd's Bush Green, just before we start, and they all pile in, and we push them in the dressing room, and then when they're needed, we call them out, don't we?
Yeah, but in reality, on a more serious level, they come from the dark recesses of our perverted minds.
It is Gorgon the Gopher! Look into his eyes, and you will turn to Oliver Stone!
Turning to Sharon Stone. Oh no! I'm tempted to look. I want to look, Bulldog. I want to look.
No, don't look. Don't look. No.
Look at me, Bulldog.
No.
Look at me.
No. I looked.
It's got to make us laugh. You can't try to guess what's right for an audience.
I really hope that the most intelligent person in the world would walk through that door and solve the secret.
Oh, dear. Well, I think the secret's safe for a bit, anyway.
Because there's one rule we all abide by.
What's that?
And that, Mr. Keith Chegwin, is that we don't do duvets!
Actually, they don't do duvets.
They don't do duvets? I don't believe
it! Oh, my God, they do!
Do you have a message for us?
Ooh, I don't know about Sting, I'll tell you something. His donkey jacket stinks! It stinks!
It really stinks!
Some of the most memorable people, I would say, were people like Sting.
What's the first instrument you ever played, and how old were you?
I used to play on the linoleum.
What's the linoleum? Can you explain that? What is that?
That was a joke.
Oh. Obviously, it's a floor. That made me look a bit stupid, so that was quite memorable.
How do you manage to stay looking so young and attractive?
That's not your question.
It is, Sam. You think Cher's a bit of a babe, don't you, really? Yeah, he does. He does, Cher.
How old are you?
9.
Just my age range. You just made it.
Why did you play the Christmas tree formation when it's clearly not working?
Well, I'm glad.
Amy, straight in there.
I have a trick. If I don't know the answer to the question they're asking, I slap my earpiece and I say, I can't quite hear you. But if you're asking what I think you're asking, and then I give my prepared stuff.
Can't sleep now. We're live on air. Stop sleeping. I suppose one of the funniest moments of the Leprechauns was on Andy's last show, when we did this thing where they had a door that was a time machine.
Oh dear.
Doesn't bode well for future career for you.
Dramatic.
Good evening, the headlines.
And it was to see what you'd look like in 20 years from now. And Andy didn't know anything about this, and I walked in and said, oh, I'll have a go.
That is the last show.
Hey!
Oh!
Hey!
Oh,
no. My mother came out instead, and it was just brilliant because Andy was rendered completely speechless.
Oh,
I feel a much older woman.
I will miss it. I used to miss doing Live and Kicking when it wasn't on, when I presented it, you know.
What will you miss most about Live and Kicking?
Emma.
Obviously, having a brilliant working on-screen relationship with Andy was, you know, the key to it. You couldn't do that kind of programme if you didn't get on with your co-host.
I think I've lost my three winners.
You haven't. Don't tell me that. Don't tell me that. Slide down there. I'll stay in the heart. And I shall read you. I shall read you my three. It's very, very difficult. In fact, I would say it's virtually impossible to find a job that is as much fun or the same sort of unique atmosphere.
So the BBC have achieved 20 years of Saturday morning broadcast, and I'm sure there's another 20 left. It's got to evolve. Providing it evolves, providing it keeps up with what the audience want and delivers quality, I think it could go on forever.
And I'll see you in September.
Bye-bye.
Live and kicking. Live and kicking.